just for you. Red magic satin flannel too. All through the morning rain again, the sun doesn't shine. Rainbows and waterfalls run through my mind.
FightSaga.com presents Real Boxing with legendary trainer Ronnie Shields.
Legendary trainer Ronnie Shields. I like the answer, or I like the sound of that. Guys, welcome to another episode of War Week Radio. Guys, we have a very long way to go and a very short time to get there. So, guys, don't want to beat around the bush. Let me introduce our featured guest, the one and only Coach Ronnie Shields. Ronnie, welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you. Nice to be back.
Well, I tell you what, because this is your show, I wanted to, give you a theme song that takes you back to possibly being an amateur in the sport of boxing. Who doesn't love the Brothers Johnson, man?
Oh, everybody does.
And we're also joined by my brother, Mr. IOTBA, Corey Bradshaw. He's going to help us introduce and interview your two young fighters who are going to be joining us in just a little bit. Guys, we're going to be interviewing also two prospects who are trained by Coach Ronnie Shields, Mr. David Stevens of Reading, Pennsylvania. He's going to be competing in the middleweight division. He's got a perfect record of 6-0 with 4 knockouts, as well as Andreas Katzourakis from Greece. He's also perfect in his professional campaign, 6-0 with 5 knockouts. He's got a fight coming up on October 23rd. Coach, big news, and I have to get your opinion on this. I have to get your insight. It was reported by ESPN's Mike Coppinger earlier today. Oscar Valdez has tested positive for a diuretic, a banned substance. He's scheduled to defend his 130-pound title versus Robson Conceição on September 10th on ESPN in the main event. That was his A sample. The test was conducted by VADA, part of the WBC Clean Boxing Program. Almost sounds like a paradox at this point. Goodness gracious. But here's what I wanted to ask you about, right? Yeah. According to Mr. Victor Conti, he said the Oscar Valdez phentermine stimulant case is much like the BJ Saunders oxylofrin case, where Saunders lost his title, $2.3 million purse, and was suspended. Phentermine and oxylofrin are potent stimulants that can enhance performance, and all state athletic commissions uphold that VADA positive test result. Is that the right course of action for Oscar Valdez or anyone who uses that diuretic? And why is it a banned substance, Ronnie?
Well, I think it's right that, you know, I mean, look, if you're a fighter, you have to know what you can use and what you can't use. And most fighters, when they get to a certain level in the sport of boxing, they use a conditioning guy. That guy should also know what's not legal and what's illegal to take. And, you know, it's no excuse for anybody to fail a drug test if you're doing the right things. Mm-hmm. And if you get caught, you deserve to be suspended, because it's not fair that the other guy who you're supposed to be fighting, look, he's already losing a purse because he can't fight and he didn't do anything. So you can't reward guys for failing drug tests. Simple as that.
Indeed. Indeed, Coach Ronnie. And I tell you what, and the reason why I bring it up, I'm asking about this because there are a lot of fans who really don't understand who's to blame for this. But you brought up strength and conditioning, Coach, because they're consistently giving them supplements to help enhance their performance, but some are legal, some are banned substances. But ultimately, you said something that I thought was very interesting, that ultimately the fighter should be held responsible because he needs to inquire about all of this. Now, I'm going to bring up Emmanuel, right? Because Emmanuel couldn't stand his fighters to be working with strength and conditioning coaches. He said, look, nothing prepares you for battle better than hard sparring. in my opinion, nothing good comes out of the strength and conditioning. It takes away from your time in the ring. And yeah, it could put you in trouble and take away your purse and take away your livelihood for a significant period of time. How do you feel about Emmanuel's thoughts?
No, I mean, I agree with him 100%. Really in the true sport of boxing, I don't know where the conditioning guy comes from. Really, truly, I don't. I don't know where he comes from. You know, because throughout my career, I've never used a conditioning guy. I never needed a conditioning guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, look, I took my multivitamins. I ran. That's the only conditioning I ever got, you know. But, you know, all of a sudden, one day, I hear, this guy's using a strength and conditioning guy. And so what is that? I didn't know what that was, you know. And, you know, really, truly, you know, I believe, you know, guys may feel they need that. But, you know, ever since we started using strength and conditioning guys been failing drug tests.
Mm.
You know.
There it is.
If you go back in the day, you know, when we used to do just a regular P test, nobody tried a drug test. You know, because nobody really, you know, you didn't take anything that was going to hurt you or that was going to be illegal because we didn't know anything about taking something that's going to enhance what you're doing. And to me, you know, it's crazy that fighters don't read about everything that they're taking because this is their career. That's on the line here, you know.
Yep.
And, you know, the strength and conditioning guy, he wants to be popular because he wants to get work from other guys also. So if he convinced somebody to do something that they ain't supposed to do and it helps them, then, hey, you know, the next guy is going to say, hey, I want to use that guy.
Mm-hmm.
So, and, you know, and you may get away with it a couple times, two or three times. But then when you get caught, who could take the blame for that?
You know what, Coach? In your opinion, should we make the penalty for failing these tests more harsh, in your opinion?
Without a doubt. Without a doubt. Because it's not fair. It's not fair, number one, to the sport of boxing. It's not fair to your opponent who you're about to fight. You know, look, boxing is a very dangerous sport. This is not something that, you know, like you're playing on the playground. This is a very serious, serious sport. And somebody can easily get hurt. And if you don't take into account that these guys are cheating, then what's the use in having a commission? What's the use in having an organization like, you know, W.A.W., B.C., I.B.F., W.B.O., what's the sense in having that if you're not going to do what's right for all the fighters?
That is an excellent point, Coach Ronnie, and I love your insight. Caray, you have a question for Coach Ronnie.
Yes, Coach Ronnie, good to be talking to you again, sir. So, in your opinion, what should be the penalty if a guy tests positive for banned substance?
Well, number one, I think they should be stripped of their belt. Because it's not like you don't know that you have to take drug tests. That's number one. But that's the crazy thing about the whole situation is you know you got to take drug tests, right?
Mm.
So why would you take anything that you know is going to fail? Whether you're talking about the fighter himself or the conditioning guy, if that's who you're going to blame it on, or even the coach, you know, somebody got to know. If you're taking something, what is it that you're taking? Is it legal? Number one, somebody should have to read up on it. And, you know, everybody can go around and say, well, I didn't know he was taking that. You know, but then the fighter might come and say, no, the conditioning guy gave it to me. Oh, no, the coach gave it to me. It's got to be whoever gave it to him, or if he gave it to himself, then he should be the only one that should be penalized. But if the coach gave it to him and he didn't ask what he's taking, then they both should be suspended.
Wow.
If the conditioning guy gave it to him, the coach knew about it, the fighter knew about it, then all three of them should be suspended.
Wow. Throw the book at him, coach.
Absolutely. Taking no prisoners.
I love it. I tell you what, coach, and we're going to be visiting with both of your fighters here in just a second. Okay. Coach, and the saddest part about this, and this is the last thing I'll say about Mr. Oscar Valdez, now it brings to question, everyone has now doubt about his sensational performance earlier this year in which he lifted the title from Miguel Burchelt. You can't help but put that in question. Are we wrong in feeling that way?
Well, you know, I would hate to feel that way because for the simple reason, he had to take drug tests for that fight also.
That is true.
And he didn't fail. So he passed. So he had to be okay. So
that's right. It was for the WBC as well. Yep.
Yes. And so if he passed, then it's, you know, you can't penalize him for passing. So everything got to be, was on up and up, you know, unless he just got away with it. But, you know, you got to go with what happens when these guys take the test. If he take the test and he pass it, hey, it's all fair. Everything is legal. So, yeah, I think, you know, he deserved to have won the title and he deserved to be world champion. But now, you know, since he failed the test, he deserved to be stripped of the title.
Wow. Well, that is a damn shame to go through all that work your entire career and have to suffer this fate. Well, I tell you what, it's going to be interesting to see what everyone, the sanctioning organization, as well as the State Athletic Commission, see what their ruling is on this. Now, Coach, we just have a couple of minutes before we speak to your fighter, Andreas. He's already in the queue. But I have to ask you, Coach, were you just shaking your head when you probably turned on TMZ and saw Jermall Charlo's mugshot there again?
Yeah. But the thing about it is, I already knew about it.
What
was coming. You know, he called me and told me, and he explained the whole situation to me. And, you know, he's going to have a day in court. So until that day, then, you know, everything is going to be fine.
Well, I tell you what, man, throw the book at that waitress. And that and that police officer that's trying to make an example out of young Jermall. That's just a shame. Because, yeah, we are on one of our shows last week. We went through all of it, the attorney's affidavit for Jermall Charlo. And, yeah, to me it sounds like a huge misunderstanding. And, yeah, Jermall, we don't see anything wrong that he did except for maybe just partying a little too hard the night before his brother was going to fight. Come on now, Maul. Come on, man. But I tell you what, at this time, it's our pleasure to welcome. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for your undefeated prospect. Guys, he's age 30 or 23. He comes from Athens, Greece. He's perfect in his professional campaign with 6 wins, 0 losses, 5 big wins coming by way of knockout. Introducing Mr. Andreas Katzourakis. Andreas, how are you doing? Welcome to the program, sir.
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
Well, I tell you what, Ronnie, first of all, sir, okay, close your ears, Andreas. Ronnie, why are you so excited about this prospect from Athens, Greece, sir?
Well, number one, because, you know, he's a really, really good guy. And he trained really hard. Had no problems in the gym. You know, guy comes to train, comes to learn. You know, that's the kind of guy I love to work with. So, and, you know, he's a really good fighter. You know, he got Jermall ready. He was one of the fighters that got Jermall ready for his last fight.
And, wow.
You know, he does really good in the gym with everybody. So, you know, he's more than welcome in our gym.
Well, man, take it easy on poor Jamal next time, man. Maybe he'll be able to knock out his opponent. So what is it like being with Coach Shields in Houston, Texas? And yeah, you come from, you were recently at Big Bear Lake in Northern California. Can you explain what happened coming from Abel Sanchez's Summit Gym over to Ronnie Shields' gym in Houston?
So I was in Big Bear for 6 to 8 months, and all of a sudden, I mean, probably something happened, but I found kind of straightforward that Abel was about to retire, and I had to move to work with a different coach. And when my guys called me, my management, and they started like telling me some names. The only name that I wanted to tell was Ronnie Shields. I didn't want to work with anybody else. Coach, you can ask them as well if you need. I didn't want to work with anybody else. Then they got in contact with coach, and once I got here, we started working a little bit together. And I guess he liked me. I loved him, and I love the way they work in the gym, and like it's very nice. It's a nice environment that you feel like you've been like home, like you have a family here. And when it's time to work, you work. There is no joking around, anything like that. You just go, you work, you do your thing, you feel good around everybody, and it's a really nice situation.
That is excellent, Andreas. And tell us about your background, because and we do have Mr. David Stevens in the queue. He's going to be joining us in about 7-8 minutes. But tell us about your background. How did you get introduced into combat sports, sir?
So I got introduced when I was very young, because my father used to be an amateur fighter in kickboxing back in Greece. So I always looked at him training and stuff like that, and I wanted to do the same thing because he was my father, of course. And around 4 years old, he got me into martial arts. Around 5 years old, I started fighting in kickboxing, in like a style of kickboxing that was more for kids. And as I developed, I started winning world championships and European championships in kickboxing. And I started competing internationally, and it was very nice. But since 14, I totally transitioned to boxing, because that was something that I really loved. And since then, I never kicked again in my life.
Wow. Wow. So what do you prefer, sir? Do you prefer boxing or kickboxing?
Oh, boxing. I mean, there is no question about it.
Do you find that there are less injury, or regardless, you're gonna receive injury in combat sport? Because every fighter insists to me, including Ronnie, that if you've had a good camp, a hard camp where you've gotten most of yourself in the gym, you never go into a fight feeling 100%. Is that the case with you, Andreas?
Well, I agree 100% with coach. And I mean, I can't even imagine how it will be being a training camp for a 12-rounder, for a world championship fight, that you even have to push yourself harder. I guess it's 100% true on what coach says. But it's not the reason that I transitioned from kickboxing to boxing. I mean, it's a totally different sport. The way that you have to think in boxing, and you have to act, and your ring IQ has to be special to be competing in a high level. And it's not like, I feel like kickboxing is more basic. You just have to have hands up, kick and punch, and that's going to be it. In boxing, it's like a totally different sport.
Yeah, indeed. Indeed. Well, I tell you what, welcome to boxing, sir. And welcome to the great Lone Star State, brother, where it's hotter than Hades.
Yeah.
It's great to cut weight in.
Easy. I mean, I was used to it because I'm from Greece, and Greece is hot. But the last 8 months, I've been to Big Bear, and it's been like a rough change. But as long as the altitude is nice and low, I'm good with it.
Mm. Yeah, it is sea level around Houston. Yeah, it's got, that's a huge change. Absolutely. So, Andreas, it's funny. Some fighters I meet, they're not huge fans of the sport. They're just good at what they do. And others, they have a lifelong passion, and they have their favorite fighters that they grew up watching. Which category do you fall into, sir?
100% the second one.
Oh, beautiful. Who were your favorite fighters then when you were developing as a young fighter?
So I'm watching a lot of old school fighters, and back in the day where they used to fight, everybody used to fight everybody, and they were like eager to be the best, not just to fight for money and stuff like that. My favorite of all time is Marvin Hagler, because I love his work ethic and the way he was applying pressure in the fight, and he was really dominant. That's why I really love him. And
mine too.
It has to be. And he was also in an era that they were fighting each other. You had four greats and they were fighting each other. And I think that's why they were so, that's why they will go down to history, because not only it was one single great fighter, but they had the right dancing partners. So yeah, I really like this era. And I've been watching a lot of, I've been watching Julian Jackson and James Toney and Mike McCallum and other middleweights and super welterweights. But of course, you have to watch the heavyweights like Mike Tyson, some great fights with Evander Holyfield and Riddick Bowie and all that kind of stuff.
Wow. So yeah, you are a real fan of the sport. Coach Ronnie, who does Andreas most remind you of in the gym, sir? Because you've seen them all, brother.
Yeah, I mean...
you can mix and match if you'd like. If he's got a jab of someone, but the footwork of someone else, you can morph the two, right?
Yeah, I mean, I would say quite a few of the guys that I've worked with, he had different, you know, he had certain things that some of the guys have. You know, like David Tour, you know, he wasn't known for a jab, but he was really known for his left hook. Mm. And Andreas had that kind of jab that David Tour had. But David Tour only used it to set up, you know, the big left hooky that he had. So, and we're working on that with Andreas, so.
I like it. Well, I tell you what, hey, we can't wait to see you compete. Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Corey Bradshaw, Mr. IOTBA, is going to ask you a question, Andreas.
Andreas, nice to meet you, man. Mr. IOTBA, Corey Bradshaw. We can see right now, Coach Ronnie, nice smile. But, you know, we hear the stories of how intense and how serious he is in training camp. Can you give us your story on Ronnie Shields and how he is in training camp?
Yeah, it is exactly what I said before. I mean, you go in the gym, you see him smiling and being nice, but when it's time to work, you have to work. It's not joking around. You can't talk or do anything like that. You have to work. And because I'm this kind of guy that I really like working, and when I go to the gym, I'm serious. I haven't felt anything from him. I haven't felt like I have agitated him or something like that. But I don't want to do it as well, because I feel he's gonna be angry if you don't get the work.
Well, I tell you what, before we move forward, and we're going to introduce Mr. David Stevens here in a couple minutes. He's waiting patiently in the queue. Thank you for being here, David. But first, I want to give a shout out to some people in the queue, right? Because they have a lot of questions for Coach Shields, and we're going to post them all on the screen as soon as his young fighters exit the show. Want to welcome Fresh BX to the program. Also, our very good friend, Young Bill. Also, Jimmy 007, welcome to the queue, sir. So, guys, get your questions ready for Coach, because he's going to address them and answer every single one of them, including the Red Fox comment, Fresh BX. We'll put that on the screen later in the show. Oh, wait till you see that, Ronnie. Goodness gracious. But I tell you what, Andreas, you do have a fight coming up on October 23rd. Do you know who it is against, or is it against the dreaded TBA at this point?
The second one again. Yeah. As long as I know, I have the fight date ready. But I mean, anything can happen in boxing. I don't want to have any negative thoughts. I mean, I'm ready to fight in 2-3 weeks. I can't wait for this one.
Excellent. Well, we can't wait to see you in the ring. Do you have any parting shots for our listening audience who look forward to watching you in the ring, sir? And I can already tell you, you're going to be great because you're awesome with the media. Very few. And Ronnie will tell you, like, he's got some fighters, man, that don't know how to open up just yet and need some coaching. But you're a natural, brother, in front of the screen. So do you have any parting shots for our listening audience at this time? We're going to tune in on October 23rd.
What do you mean, parting shot?
just address the audience, sir. Just let them know what to expect when you step foot in the ring next time.
They have to expect what I'm bringing every fight. I'll apply pressure. I'm looking for the knockout. Of course, I'm not being... I will not be clumsy or anything like that. But the knockout will come. The knockout will come eventually. I will apply pressure, and it will be definitely a fight to watch.
Outstanding, guys. His name is Andreas Katzourakis, guys. Be on the lookout for the young man from Greece. Andreas, thank you so much for being on the program. Thank you, sir. It's been a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you, Andreas. Thank you.
Guys, at this time, it's my pleasure to welcome a young fighter, 21 years of age, fights out of the orthodox stance. He stands 5'11.5" tall in the center of the ring from Reading, Pennsylvania. He's got a perfect record in his professional campaign, 6 wins, 0 losses, 4 big wins coming by way of knockout, guys. Introducing Mr. David Stevens. David, welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you. Pleasure.
I tell you what, and close your eyes for just a second, or close your ears, I should say, David, because Ronnie, what makes you so excited about this young man, David Stevens?
Well, you know, you got a little inside joke at the gym. They call him, you know, they call their brother Manny Pacquiao because his legs are so big. You know, you can't believe the calves on this guy.
Okay, they can't be any bigger than David Tua's, though, right?
No, not that big, but...
Yeah. He had tree trunks, Ronnie.
Yes, he did. No, man, but
tell us
excited.
About... I'm excited. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead, Coach.
David. I'm really excited for David because, you know, I can see in his eyes that this kid, he wants to become champion of the world. You know, he learned, he's listening to everything that I'm telling him in the gym. He's learning everything that he can possibly learn. And, you know, that's what it's all about. You know, I don't claim to know everything, but, you know, I've been around to where I've seen a lot. And, you know, and I'm really excited when I get somebody that really wants to learn and that's going to do everything that he can possibly do in order to become that champion of the world.
Outstanding. So David, at 21 years of age, what is it like training with one of the legends of the sport, Coach Ronnie Shields?
I mean, this is like my sixth day down here, but I'm already pretty decided on like what I want to do and stuff. Like, you know what I mean? I haven't even been able to really, you know, demonstrate nothing in the ring, but I just, you know, I'm enjoying it. I like what I'm learning, even the little things I'm learning. Everybody at the gym treats me, you know, like I've been there. So, you know, I mean, it's pretty great.
Outstanding. You know, it's funny. Most fighters insist to me, David, that they didn't choose boxing, but boxing chose them. How did you get introduced in this sport? And do you feel that was the case in your career?
I'm not sure. No, I was real bad when I was younger. Bad.
We have never heard that before, ever, David.
That's a different schools in third grade, and it kind of followed up. But then when I was 12 or 11, my parents, you know, they made me start boxing because of the discipline and stuff. And I didn't really like it at first. I would try to, like, sneak out. But then I seen, like, you could have amateur fights and stuff, and I just started taking it serious a little bit more from that point and started, you know, getting disciplined to the point where I couldn't train if I was being bad in school and stuff like that. So I just chilled out for, started, you know, being more respectful and stuff like that.
And I tell you what, yeah, I mean, so any message to any young kids who are currently, who are going to watch this and are currently on that bubble tinkering, would you recommend this to any kid who is having trouble in school or with their family at home? Would you recommend the camaraderie and the brotherhood of boxing?
Oh yeah, for sure. But you know, you want to find whatever, you know, works for you as long as it's positive, because you know, one day you're going to look back and be like, damn, I was a brat, or just like, you know. But whatever works for them, boxing for me, you know, That's what it was.
Yeah, and then I'm sure as you were becoming a decorated amateur, you started to realize, hey, I'm actually pretty good at this. Do you think it's did you discover and you said, well, geez, I'm a bad kid. Is it that mean streak that separates you, that started separating you from your amateur competition?
I don't know, not really. It was just, you know, I don't like to say I had that mean streak, but, you know, just wanting to win. And, getting close to the championships and then just winning national championships, it's not luck. So I just, you know, keep training hard and stuff.
Wow. And, yeah, you're perfect in your campaign so far. 6-0 with 4 knockouts. Who have been your biggest influences in learning this game?
Well, when I first started, I didn't really know any new boxers. So obviously everybody, I'd watch a lot of Ali, a lot of Tyson, because, you know, everybody likes to watch someone that's really, you know, downing everybody. So I was really into Tyson. I was really into a lot of the older guys before I kind of started watching newer boxing. People like Tyson, you know, Floyd a little bit. He's not really one of my favorite fighters, but everybody looks up to Floyd and stuff. Guys like that.
Yeah. So when you look at the business today, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Caray. Mr. IOTBA has a question for you, sir.
Hey, David Stevens, Mr. IOTBA, Caray Bradshaw. Nice to meet you. Your coach, Ronnie Shields, said they have an inside joke because your legs are real big like Manny Pacquiao. But who would you say your style is compared to if we look at any of these boxers out here today?
I mean, honestly, I don't know. I felt like even in the amateurs, I really wouldn't know what to call my style. So, I mean, I'm going to just let Ronnie say that when the time for real. I feel like I could do a little bit of everything, but, you know, I don't know.
So is the young Mr. Stevens, is he indeed a chameleon in the ring, Coach?
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt. You know, let me tell you something, man. You know, just for the last few days that we've had a chance to work on different things. And, you know, I just see something in him that I'm trying to bring out, you know. And, you know, and he's never said anything as far as, you know, nah, I don't like that or I don't like this. You know, he knows that I'm trying to teach him what I think is going to work for him inside of that ring. And, you know, so far, man, everything is going great, you know, and purposely right now, we're not sparring right now because I'm just trying to get him to learn everything he possibly could right now. So when we do take that next step and get in the ring, then, you know, it won't be so new to him.
Well, in terms on instilling proper fundamentals, you were with the right guy, David. Coach Ronnie is the best in the business at making sure you're razor sharp on the fundamentals of boxing. That's why everyone gravitates towards this gentleman right here. I tell you what, it's really interesting. So Coach Ronnie tells me that you're currently campaigning at light heavyweight, but you want to try and melt down to compete at 160. And what is the timetable look like in that? How long do you think before you start campaigning at middleweight?
I don't know. I mean, this Texas. So that once it's like in stone that you're cutting weight, I think soon, because like it's just so hot out here. I'm not gonna lie. I brought Jack. Help me lose weight.
So you don't need it.
No, you don't need it here, brother.
I mean, every time I leave the gym, I'm super, super stoked. So, I think once it's time to cut weight, I'll make it.
Excellent, excellent. Coach Ronnie, when is his next fight? Do you have anything on the calendar as of yet?
No, not yet. You know, like I said, we just started, you know, it's been about 6 days now. And we're just, you know, starting to get things together. So, you know, his manager, Michael Miller, you know, he's working on things right now. So he'll call me and let me know, you know, then he'll call me and say, how much time you think we need before we take a fight and, you know, things like that. So we'll have a meeting on that And then, you know, but hopefully within the next, you know, 4 to 6 weeks that we'll find out something, you know, something is cooking on the horizon.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, yeah, if you're going to be, if your target is currently campaigned in the middleweight division, well, I'm sure within the next super middleweight division. My apologies. Yeah. 168. Yeah. Well, you're going to probably join there very soon by the young Mr. Well, not so young anymore, Mr. Jamal Charlo. He's going to be campaigning very soon and going after Canelo Alvarez. I'm going to ask you, David, test your knowledge. Who wins that fight and why? Jamal Charlo versus Canelo Alvarez. How do you see that style matchup playing out, sir?
I mean, I don't want to make it a race thing, but I'm real into like all African-American fighters, so I'm going to go with USA. If I see one like Jamal work, I feel like I'm going to really know what's up. Because Andreas has told me some things, so once I see it, I feel like I'll really... You already know I'm going with, but
that's all right, because I'm sure if you ask Canelo, as well as his Mexican fan base, they'd probably have the same answer, brother. You know, and that's another thing I have to ask you. Are you prepared for this? Because we don't have any teams to root for, obviously from Reading, Pennsylvania, if you're an NFL fan, you're going to gravitate towards either the Eagles or the Steelers. If you're from our neck of the woods, you're either going to gravitate towards the Texans or the Cowboys. Unfortunately, we don't have that in America. So what do you think about the tribalism currently in boxing? Do you see that as being a potential problem in galvanizing the fan base moving forward? Do you see that as a problem in sponsorship or any of that stuff?
Not really. Not really. I don't even be worried about that stuff for real.
That's for Mike Miller, right?
But I don't know. I don't really get into that.
Well, good man, brother. Just do your thing in the ring. Do you have any parting shots for our listening audience before give them a taste of what to expect in the future in 2022 from Mr. David Stevens?
I don't know. It's going to be a surprise. I've been here a few days, and I already feel like my opponents are really going to start feeling some pain. So I don't want to call a bunch of knockouts.
Excellent. Well, David, thank you so much for being on the program, sir. And we look forward to seeing you fight. And, yeah, we'd love to have you back as soon as you get a fight announced on the calendar. We'd love to have you back so you can discuss that. Thank you so much for being on the air, sir.
Appreciate you. Y'all have a good one.
God bless you, brother.
See you tomorrow.
Yeah, you'll be seeing it tomorrow, Coach. Yeah. Well, I tell you what, as I promised some guys on the boards, we were going to feed. Now, Coach, I'm going to show you this just because this guy thinks he's actually asking you a hard question, but he's just making a comment. And I'm referring to you, Fresh BX. Ah, boy. Okay. I'm going against my better judgment, but I'm going to show you, Coach. You ready for this?
I'm ready.
Fresh BX says, I like Ronnie Shields. He reminds me of Fred Sanford, but I got to call him out on it. Okay. Fresh BX.
I don't mind that because I love Fred. I used to watch Fred Sanford all the time. So,
I love Red Fox, but he takes that as a compliment. Outstanding. The genius that was Red Fox. But I've got one thing to tell you, Fresh BX. How would you like it if I put five across your lip?
Or Elizabeth, I'm coming to join you, honey.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, the genius of Red Fox. I tell you what. Oh, what a genius he was, man. Young millionaire. Welcome to the show. He says, let's go, Uncle Ronnie. Uncle Ronnie. I like the sound of that. Tell you what, let's see. Okay. You know what, Coach? Can we put this to bed once and for all? You've stated this on our previous show back when we were on the air several years ago, but apparently this still comes up to our listening audience. So would you mind addressing this one more time, right? Jimmy 007 says, why won't Charlo fight Andrade? That's the fight the boxing world wants. Why is Charlo fighting non-champions for less money? Well, I wouldn't say that, because it's not like Boo Boo Demetrius Andrade brings a ton of money, but we'll let the coach answer this one once and for all. But after this, guys, I don't want to hear this question again. As you were, Coach Shields.
Okay. So a few years ago when I was training Jermell Charlo, I was training Jermell and Jermell at the same time. So Jermell signed a contract to fight Demetrius Andrade for his world title. So, unbeknownst to me and anybody else, I guess, he was having, I guess, problems with his promoter or whatever, but he wanted to switch from being with his promoter to go to Jay-Z, you know, the rapper Jay-Z, who has Rock Nation. So I don't know who told him that he shouldn't fight Jermell, but it was rumored that Jay-Z told him, don't fight Jermell. You know, you don't need that fight right now. So Demetrius pulled out of the fight. And he pulled out, you know, it's for the world title. And he pulled out of the fight. So both brothers say, you know what? They would never allow Demetrius Andrade to make one dime off of them. That's it.
And there it is, Jimmy 007. So let's put that to bed forever, right? And come on. You know, you could ask the same thing to Gennady Golovkin. You could ask the same thing to Jaime Munguia, right? You could ask the same thing to Sergey Derevyanchenko. Why aren't they fighting Demetrius Boo Boo Andrade? And everyone's going to have a very similar answer. Because he's got a stinker of a style and he doesn't bring any money to the table. He's considered by most to be more risk than reward. We don't need it, right? Coach, what's the most difficult style to prepare against in boxing?
But you know what, man? You know, it's hard to tell. It just depends on who the fighter is, you know, because, you know, not all southpaws are awkward. You know, not all right-handers are awkward either.
Yep.
So, but, you know, I've seen a lot of – I have a guy that I work with sometimes. You know, he's got to be the most awkward right-hander I've ever seen in my life. And he makes everybody look bad. But, you know, it just depends on the styles that both fighters have, you know. And even, like, when you have a big fight, you know, sometimes – you'll be like, man, I paid for this, you know, but what people don't understand is the styles are so different that, you know, that it makes for an ugly fight. And that's what you get sometimes, you know, just because you say this name and this name are the two biggest names in boxing and they fight, that don't mean you'll get the best fight. That might
indeed
mean you get the worst fight.
Indeed. Just look at a couple weeks ago. Who would have thought Casimiro would be that inept on trying to cut off the ring and close the distance against Guillermo Rigondeaux? Didn't make for an entertaining fight, Coach.
Well, you know my answer to that.
Yep, and guys, in case you missed last week's show, we still have all those segments on the air. Coach, one last question, and then we're going to talk about – well, some fond memories, because after all of this Oscar Valdez bad news, we need to reminisce about the glory years, right? So Mr. Young Billionaire says, Coach, besides the jab, what is the best attribute that Jermall Charlo possesses?
Well, Jermall has a really, really good right hand, but I think personally his uppercut, his right uppercut.
Ooh.
Has to be the, not only is it good, it's probably the strongest punch he has, that right uppercut. Ask Julian Williams about it.
Well, you could also ask Sergey Derevyanchenko about it.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, him too.
Well, he did a brilliant job. You know what? And that was a very tough fight, the last half of the fight. And, yeah, Jamal really held his own even when he was against the ropes. And I could hear you because there was no crowd, Coach. I could hear you screaming about him, get off the ropes.
Yeah. Well, you know, I just like to for the guy to practice what we preach, you know? And
oh, of course. Of course.
Know, and but, you know, sometimes we decoy things. I really don't want him to get off, but I might say it just to, you know, make the other guy think something. And, you know, I might want him to stay there.
Mm. And there you have it. And there you have it. Thank you for the question, young Bill. Thank you for the question, everyone. And I tell you what, I've got a question, Coach. And just, you know, it brings back when you're yelling at Jamal, get off the ropes, get up, you know, and you're screaming at him. What is it like when you're talking to a guy like Guillermo Rigondeaux in the corner and you're telling him, hey, man, why don't you sit down on your shots more? This guy is there to be tagged every single time he comes in. You can win this fight, but it's not a good life. And you were giving perfect advice throughout that fight in the corner and your fighter's not having any part of it. How do you handle that situation, Coach?
Well, you know, I just have to keep doing my job. You know, the thing about it is this is why, you know, you have a training camp so you can iron all that stuff out. So he knows what I'm going to say. He knows what's coming. But sometimes fighters have a different, you know, that they get a different plan in their head that they think will work for them, you know. And look, you know, I think if you'd have sit down a little bit more, he won the fight so easy, you know. But sometimes, you know, I think in the first round, when the guy pushed him down and started hitting him in the back of the head, you know, I think that might have some effect on him that, you know, well, maybe I shouldn't get too close to this guy. But
it's a very good point.
You know, you have to stick with the plan, though, you know. And I told him this after the fight, that, you know, if you'd have stuck with the plan, you know, you win the fight so easy, you know. But, you know, he just had in his mind that he could win that way. And look, you know, it's his career. It's, you know, he has to do what he thought he had to do, you know. And obviously, you know, one judge thought he did enough to win the fight. And, you know, so it doesn't make it wrong that he didn't listen to me completely, but it doesn't make it right either because, you know, one judge saw that, you know, what he was doing was right.
Hey, Coach Ronnie.
Well, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Mr. Allen, TBA.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir. I want to backdoor that question. With you having so much experience, right, and I know that's very frustrating for you as a coach, when you're giving out, you know, the game plan or y'all went through the game plan for the 12-week training camp. Do that make you second guess fighters? And if you want to work with them, again, if you put in a full game plan, 12-week training camp, and the guy don't go out there and do what you guys worked on?
Well, I mean, you know, sometimes I would think about that sometimes. But, you know, the thing about Guillermo is, you know, I knew his background from the very beginning. And, you know, for me, working with him early in his career also, you know, I know he was the same way. You know, he loves to box. That's the thing. He loves using his legs. And, you know, I have no problem with that. But I always told him from the very beginning that if I need you to sit down a little bit, then that might could be the difference between you winning and losing a fight. So, you know, ultimately, it's up to the fighter, you know, if he's going to continue to do what the trainer asks. You know, sometimes, you know, look, the trainer not always right on everything, but sometimes, you know, a fighter, he may make some different adjustments and it may work, you know. But in his case, you know, fighting in California, I knew that it was going to be tough for him to win boxing so much. Because of my experience of being there, you know, in California, so many fights and losing, you know. But I can tell you a fight when I had Brian Vera fight Julio Cesar Chavez Jr.
Oh, boy. I remember that. You
know, and, you know.
Talking about the first or the second, Coach?
The first one was in California. The second was in San Antonio. Excuse me. But, you know, it was the opposite. You know, Chavez was more on the outside. Brian was steady putting the pressure the whole fight. And he loses a decision. You know, so it's damn if you do and damn if you don't in California. You know, and it all depends on the name.
That's right. The second was indeed in the Alamo Dome. And I remember I was ringside for that. I covered that at the Alamo Dome. And I remember hearing you yell from the corner. And then you later told me, yeah, I found out Brian Vera broke his hand during the fight. We couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
Oh, tough night at the fights, Coach. But I tell you what, let's go back in time for a second, Coach. We're running out of time here. Let's go back in time, though, to 2002. Coach, your superstar, deep amateur background, former 1992 Olympian. But once again, this gentleman was in the shadow of Oscar De La Hoya. He was getting all the glory. The golden boy turning pro out of the Barcelona Olympics. And everyone forgot about Vernon Forrest. In fact, he didn't get his big date of destiny until he was already a pro for 9 years. So, Coach, leading up to that first fight against the pound-for-pound king at the time, Sugar Shane Mosley, what was the mindset of Vernon Forrest, and what was the game plan putting that brilliant fight together?
Well, you know, the thing about it was with Vernon, you know, he didn't care that Shane was getting so much publicity and that Shane was beating Oscar and all of those guys. He didn't worry about that. He said, you know what? Shane is this and Shane is that, and people love Shane. That's great. He said, and I want him to keep getting to be a big star because I'm going to take it away from him. I'm going to take that star from him.
Wow.
And he said, the same way I did in the Olympic trials. He said, I'm going to do the same thing when I fight Shane as a professional. He said, so I want that. I want to see him get all the accolades. He said, because once I beat him, all that turns to me. And look, it happened for him. You know, it happened. And, you know, it was, that's probably was one of the biggest fights for me that I've ever been in, and Vernon just made it look so easy, you know, and it was crazy because when we first wanted to get that fight, Shane was like, oh yeah, absolutely. You know, I got to get my revenge from the amateurs, you know, and he kept saying at the press conference, this ain't the amateurs, this is different, blah, 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 you know, and, you know, and we just laughed because, you know, looking at Vernon's style, I knew that with the length, with the power, there's no way in the world Shane was going to be able to touch him. Because Shane fought some good fights with Oscar, but they was really close, you know? And Oscar definitely was no Vernon Forrest.
Yep, indeed. 6 feet tall, Coach, at 147 pounds. Chihuahua. And you know what? The biggest knock on Vernon Forrest, they said, well, he's an outstanding amateur, former Olympian. He's a complete fighter, but he doesn't do any one thing particularly well. What was your answer to all of those critics who had that opinion of Vernon Forrest leading up to the Sugar Shane Mosley fight?
Well, you know, I went back with Vernon and with Al Mitchell. You know, we looked at Vernon's fight with Shane in amateurs. And the first thing I said was, what has changed with Shane? And the answer was, nothing. He's the same guy. He does nothing different in the pros than he did in amateurs. The only thing is, he's fighting longer rounds. You know, he's fighting more rounds. So it's no different. So we told Vernon, look, man, with your length and with your stamina and with your combinations, this is not going to be hard for you. This is, it's the same fight you fought when you beat him in an Olympic trials, but it's just going to be longer. Vernon really wants to knock him out, you know?
And I thought he was going to in the second round, Coach.
Absolutely. Absolutely. When he hit him with that uppercut, I thought it was over. Oof. You know?
I thought the back of head was gonna hit, I thought the back of his head was gonna hit his trunks.
Hey, Coach Ronnie. Coach Ronnie, you just spoke on that, but with you, you have the experience that amateurs does matter, because Vernon Forrest did beat Sugar Shane in the amateurs, right? I want to ask you a direct question. You have a lot of guys say amateurs don't matter when you come to the pros. Can you define that, sir?
Oh, amateur experience means a lot in the pros.
Yep.
I mean, it does, man. It gets you prepared for the pros. That's just without a doubt that, you know, you learn so much in the amateurs, because you fight so many different styles in the amateurs that you're not going to fight in the pros. But in the amateurs, you know, it's go get it time, you know. In the pros, you can more relax because you're going longer rounds. You know, you might be going fight 8 rounds or whatever. But in the amateurs, them 3 rounds, they go by fast. And, you know, you have to do a whole lot of work in 3 rounds. But not everybody can transition from the amateurs to the pros and be successful. But the thing about it is, in the amateurs, man, this is where you learn everything. You see everything. So when you turn pro, man, professional boxing is so much easier than the amateur boxing. So much easier.
Yep, because you've got an entire camp to prepare for an opponent. How long do you have during a tournament, like, say, the Pan Am Games, how long do you have to prepare for your next opponent, Coach?
A day.
That's
it. But just think about it. You know, if you're in training camp, and let's just say you go to the Olympics, right? Let's say you have 32 guys in your bracket, right? So everybody got a different style. Nobody has the same style. So how can you prepare for every style? Because you don't know. But as soon as they get the brackets and then you find out who you're fighting, you may have never seen that guy before in your life. It may have no video on him, no nothing. Nobody's ever seen him before. Now you're going in blind. But you know what? He's going in blind on you too. So, you know, that makes it hard. Mm-hmm. You know, now, you know, you only have 3 rounds to do it. So, you know, you have to get it. And you have to be smart. You have to be quick thinking. You know, that's what makes amateur boxing so hard.
Indeed, indeed. And guys with a huge amateur background, like Vasily Lomachenko, Alexander Usyk, Arthur Beterbiev, that's why you see them moved along a lot quicker, and they don't have to go through that 4, 6, 8 round stage like a lot of other young professionals. But I tell you what, Coach, we're just about out of time. And you know what, Fresh BX, I'm just going to say this, and I hope you're still listening. Your questioning, with your line of questioning, you would make a terrible journalist. A terrible journalist. I'm not even going to bother. I'm not even going to bother wasting the coach's time with that nonsense. But God bless you, brother. Thank you for tuning in. So, Coach, here it is. Are you ready, brother? A very abridged version of fact or fiction. Are you ready, sir?
Let's do it.
All right. Number one, the success of Jake Paul will once again draw Floyd Mayweather out of retirement in 2022. Fact or fiction?
Fiction. Don't say
you think he's done, huh?
Well, he should be done. But, you know, but money has a way of changing people's mind.
Yeah, because I tell you what, leading up to this point, every time someone seems to be progressing as one of the sport's biggest stars, Floyd always have to come out of retirement and remind everyone, hey man, I'm the breadwinner in this business. And you know what? It wouldn't surprise me, Coach, if he did that and challenged Jake Paul next year.
Absolutely. Next year? What about this year?
Oh, geez. Later, bite your tongue, Coach. No, but I tell you what, it wouldn't surprise me. It wouldn't surprise me one bit. Floyd and his ego. You know what? In fact, in first class, I think he has to purchase an extra ticket just for his ego to sit next to him. Chingao, man. So here is the next fact or fiction, number two. Are you ready, Coach?
Let's do it.
Manny Pacquiao will officially announce his retirement from boxing on his 43rd birthday in December. Fact or fiction?
I think it's a fact. I think probably only because he wants to run for president of the Philippines. I really don't think he feel he can beat Usman. I think from the last fight, man, he probably said to himself, why am I doing this? I fought a younger guy, I fought a smarter guy, and to go back to have a longer training camp than I did last time to fight him, I better just stick and go and run for president.
I think you're right, Coach. I think you're right. That was a pretty decisive loss at the hands of Yordanias Ugas. Number three, Coach, Mauricio Lara will once again stop Josh Warrington in Leeds this Saturday on DAZN. Fact or fiction?
I think it's a fact. I think he has his number.
You know what? I think you're absolutely right, boy. And talk about that style. When you're fighting a guy who fights, has a good chin, heavy hands, and puts on that relentless pressure, boy, how tough is that to deal with, Coach?
Yeah, that's a nightmare.
Oh, boy. Yeah. Well, good luck, Josh. You're going to need it, brother. Number four. Number four. I concur, though, Coach. I think you're absolutely right on the money. Number four, Chocolatito Gonzalez will defeat El Gallo Estrada in their rubber match later this year.
I think it's fiction. I think Estrada has his number.
Wow. You know what? I don't know, Coach. That first contest was... Who did you think won that second fight, Coach? The one that happened earlier this year.
You know what? I didn't see the second one, so I can't...
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, I tell you what. Let's hope that it's just as action-filled, because that was... El Gallo Estrada won that one, and that was... Fight of the Year candidate written all over it. In fact, that's my current fight of the year, truth be known. Number five, here's a big one, Coach. Jamel Herring will upset Shakur Stevenson and retain his WBO 130-pound title on October 23rd in Atlanta.
Well, here's my take on that, right? I don't think it would be an upset if Jamel Herring wins, which I like Shakur Stevenson a lot. He's a good fighter, but I'm going with Jamel Herring. I think he's going to retain. I do. I really think he's going to retain. But he's a smart fighter. He's a very smart fighter. He's a good fighter. And not to say that Shakur isn't, but Shakur is still a bit young. And he haven't been through what Jamel Herring has been through. And I think Jamel Herring is going to prove that on October 23rd.
Pearls of wisdom, Coach. Pearls of wisdom. Yeah, he showed us a lot, didn't he, against Carl Frampton?
Absolutely.
Yeah, in my opinion, that was a real eye-opening performance. And congratulations to both guys for just getting this fight.
It's
going to be terrific. Coach, last one. Are you ready?
Let's do it.
Gervonta Davis will stop Rolly Romero later this year within three rounds and retire him from boxing. Fact or fiction?
I'm going to say fiction. Rolly can run for three rounds. So, Gervonta would have to. Look, I think because these guys know each other, I don't know if they ever sparred together. They may have, since both of them is with Floyd. But look, you know, I like Ronnie a lot. You know, he's a good, decent fighter. But Gervonta, you know, it depends on what weight they fight. If they fight at 140, then I think Ronnie, he can go rounds. He could definitely go some rounds. And I think it'll take Tank more than 3 rounds to get it.
But, you know, my question is, Coach, why are they even discussing this fight? They're poles apart in terms of level. Do you think maybe Floyd is considering cashing in Rolly because of all the talk of retirement?
Well, yeah, I think Floyd want to show him who's boss, you know, and get him a good payday and get him up, you know. But, you know, it's a crazy thing, you know. Rolly, in his mind, he thinks he can win. He can't win. He's going to get knocked out. But I think he go around. So.
Wow. I tell you what. All right. Very good. We've got one last comment from our brother Peter. Says, how do you beat Pernell Whitaker at his prime, Coach? Legendary fighter. Well, he sure was. I'll do one. I'll add this to it, Coach. Okay? And this is a bonus. Fact or fiction bonus. Who wins, Coach? In a mythical matchup at 135 pounds, Pernell Whitaker or Roberto Duran?
I go with Pernell Whitaker all day long.
Wow.
You know, Pernell Whitaker in his prime, nobody can touch him. Nobody. I don't see it. You know, Roberto Duran had the power. He had the skills to get on top of you. But Pernell Whitaker, you know, he had everything to counter everything. And I just don't see anybody at 135 standing a chance against Pernell Whitaker.
Wow. Okay. Correa, here's one for you, Correa. Very quickly. We have 1 minute left. Very quickly, Correa. Aaron the Hawk Pryor versus Pernell Whitaker at 140 pounds. What say you, Coach?
I still got to go with the Sweet Pea. I think Pernell Whitaker still... You know, look, the Hawk was my roommate in Olympic trials.
Wow.
So, yeah, when
I was roommate. My favorite fighter ever, but, Coach. That's my favorite fighter of all time, the Hawk.
Good fighter, good guy too, man. But he couldn't touch Pernell Whitaker. Pernell would have been swinging at him all day long. Couldn't touch him.
That's amazing. You know, Ring Magazine did say he was in the top, I think he was the number 10 ranked fighter all time over the last 80 years.
Absolutely. I agree.
Wow. Yeah. An all time great. God rest your soul, young Pernell. Tell you what, gone too quickly, but Ronnie, we're also going to have to bid you adieu and you're going to be gone too quickly right here off the show. I tell you what, it just flies by when you're on the air, sir. But do you have any parting shots for our listening audience?
Just keep watching boxing and have fun.
God bless you, Coach. Thank you so much for being on the program, brother. And guys, if you missed any part of this program, it'll be available for replay as soon as we exit the program. But on behalf of Coach Ronnie Shields, on behalf of Mr. IOTVA, I'm Joseph Heron. You've been listening to War Week Radio. Have a wonderful evening, everybody.
From you, red magic satin playing near too.